Well, good morning, New Life. This is a very special Sunday. We've been waiting a long time for this. We've been quarantined and worshiping virtually from home for the past 10, 11 weeks. So there's a subset of us that are here today at the church, and it is good to be back to be worshiping together. But we also know that there's a lot of you that are worshiping virtually, and we will keep this up and running as long as we can. We want to serve the church well. And so whether you're here physically with us or whether you're worshiping virtually at home, we are thankful that you're here with us and worshiping together. In light of everybody being together for the first time in a long time, I'm going to be reading from Psalm 33 for today's call to worship. And as I do, I'm going to ask you to stand with me if you're able. Shout for joy in the Lord, O you righteous. Praise befits the upright. Give thanks to the Lord with a lyre. Make melody to him with the harp of 10 strings. Sing to him a new song. Play skillfully on the strings with loud shouts. For the word of the Lord is upright, and all his work is done in faithfulness. He loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of the steadfast love of the Lord. Let's pray together. Father, thank you that we can gather together as your people who have been called by name. Thank you for loving us and for adopting us into this household of faith. And it is so good to be back together as a church, for many of us here physically being able to worship together. And I pray, God, that in the midst of everything that is taking place, that we can declare and we can sing that your steadfast love continues on and on. And so as we gather to worship you, we pray that the name of Jesus will be exalted and your people will be strengthened today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now please remain standing as we sing our first song of praise.
Our Father, everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty, through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Our judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light, forever seated high. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. And I believe in you. Jesus Christ. is Lord. I believe in life eternal. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Please join me as I lead us in prayer. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created. Father, you are perfect, pure, separate from us, the definition of goodness in who you are. By your being and by your action, you deserve more praise than we can ever give, higher praise than your created universe can muster. You chose us to be yours, you blessed us with what we cannot earn, and you are with us now and forever. You, the one true God, have chosen to love us, even though we are rebels. Please forgive us for turning from you to our own ways, and thank you for both paying our debt and gifting us righteousness by the suffering and obedience of Christ, the Son of God. We were dead in sin, and you made us alive. We need to remind ourselves, and as brothers and sisters in Christ, remind each other of your love for us, which you have proven over and over, and that you never have left us, nor will you ever. You are with us always to the end of the age, and we have the Holy Spirit as our divine comforter. Nothing can separate us from your love. Nothing, not famine or distress or persecution. We are in your hand and you will not let us go. We need that assurance, Father, and thank you for the testimony of the saints who've gone before us to encourage and strengthen us. Yet your comfort, your assurance, does not eliminate trials in this life. In fact, you told us to expect them. In our difficulties, we ask for deliverance, if you will. Perseverance to continue to trust you, humility to obey. Please grant sufficient work to those suffering financially, and may those who are able give cheerfully in worship of and thankfulness to you. We ask for healing for our brothers and sisters battling sickness and injury, for patience in the difficult and painful process, and for comfort in knowing that you are with them each and every minute. Thank you, too, for the encouragement we receive from their testimony of your goodness and faithfulness. We also request your comfort with those who cannot be visited by loved ones or who cannot visit loved ones due to the current restrictions. Please be with families and their love and unity during the extended times together. Help us individually to be more patient and gracious and humble. We need wisdom, Father, as we lack it. Many difficult decisions continue to need to be made as families, as a church body, as broader communities. We pray for wisdom in considering options and making choices, and especially for those responsible for large numbers of people. And we pray for peace, a supernatural peace that comes from only you. It is easy to be distressed and discouraged by the strife we see in the world around and among us. But help us to individually strive for and to encourage others to strive for what you say is good, to act justly, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with you, our God, our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. In the name of Christ, God the Son, who became man for our salvation, we pray. Amen. Now please join us in singing the Song of Approach.
true Son. Thou in me dwelling, and I with thee one. Riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Thou mine inheritance, now and always. Thou and thou only first in my heart. I keep
We're returning today to our series entitled The Spirit-Driven Life, The Person God is Transforming You to Be. We interrupted it with the COVID-19 sermons. Just to refresh your memory, right? The Christian's DNA is mapped out in Galatians 5. Paul calls it the fruit of the Spirit. And so far, we've looked at five aspects of the fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, and kindness. And today, we're going to look at goodness. And to do that, we're going to unpack Micah chapter 6, verses 6 through 8. Micah 6, 6 through 8. Would you please stand for the reading of God's word? With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. This is God's word. You may be seated. Let's pray. Father, as your people, we want to be good. We want to be good people. Help us to understand what that means, and by your Spirit, work in us, transform us into your goodness, that we might mirror the goodness of Jesus. We pray in his name. Amen. I'm guessing that if you ask the average man or woman on the street if he or she is a good person, the answer would probably be yes. Right? And if that man or woman had some belief in God, right, he or she would probably also likely say that being a good person is spiritually sufficient, that their concept of God is that, look, if you're a good person, and I'm a good person, and if God's real, I'll be okay with God. Of course, what do we really mean, though, when we say we're good, or when you say you're a good person, right? If God is real, and if he is someone to be reckoned with, shouldn't we be lifting our sights sort of above what the culture says is good, right? And inquire about what God says is good. God's the ultimate arbiter of goodness. And here he really lays out what is good. Today we're going to unpack that under three headings. First, what goodness is not. Second, what goodness is. And then third, the power that transforms you into a person marked by goodness. Okay? That's our outline. What goodness is not, what goodness is, the power that transforms you into a good person. So, first, what goodness is not? Well, it's clearly not adding more religious ritual and devotion and sacrifice to your life, right? In verses 6 and 7, you have this, the voice of a worshiper inquiring, you know, what he has to do to come before God and be accepted. And it's an intensifying list of things, right? It starts with burnt offerings of calves, and then it escalates to thousands of rams, and then it escalates to 10,000s of rivers of oil, and then finally to the unthinkable, although not the unprecedented, not only in Israel, but in that whole region at that time, and that's human sacrifice, right? Bringing as a sacrifice to the Lord your firstborn child. And to that, Micah says a definitive no. Just no, right? And there's really kind of a rebuke there. He says, you know, the Lord's already told you what is good. You know what's good. And ramping up, you know, religious exercises, religious rituals, is not it. Okay. Now, we don't, you know, do sacrifices, but we can fall into the same kind of thinking, right? It's if you're thinking that by ramping up your church attendance, or you know, adding a Bible study to your schedule, or giving more money to the church, if you are doing those things with the intent of making yourself a good person in God's eyes, then you haven't understood Micah's message, and you really haven't understood the gospel. Goodness is not even being fair or kind or humble, so long as you're being fair and kind and humble so that God will find you to be a good person and therefore an acceptable person, right? Look at the last line. It is walk humbly with your God. You see, this is there's already a pre-existing relationship here between the person and God, right? This is spoken to people who have already accepted God and are living by faith in him. Now, of course, I'm not saying that, you know, going to church or, you know, making offerings and being just and kind and humble are bad things. Of course, they're not bad things. But as tactical moves to make yourself a good person in God's eyes, it doesn't work. that what Micah is doing here is not mapping out what we might call a roadmap to salvation. This isn't about salvation. This is how God's people are supposed to live. They're already God's people. Right? So that's what goodness is not. What is it? What goodness is now? And according to our text here, it's really four things. Okay? The first thing that goodness is responsive to God's prior goodness. Your goodness is responsive to God's prior goodness. In verses 1 through 5 of chapter 6 that we didn't read, God reminded his people of how he had saved them from slavery in Egypt in the Exodus. And the problem with their desire to bring sacrifices now to God in the wake of his salvation of them was that they were misapprehending what the sacrifices were all about, right? The sacrifices were never ultimately about what God's people could give to God, right? In some kind of bargain, which is exactly what we make them, right? Whether you're bringing an animal or whether you're writing a bigger check, right? It's very easy to think that I'm giving to God and we're going to establish some sort of a quid pro quo and he will give back to me. No, you see, God is showing that they've completely misunderstood that. The sacrifices were all about what God would ultimately give to his people, right? His ultimate rescue. The Exodus, as well as the whole sacrificial system, was really designed to be a trailer in history, showing us the true sacrificial lamb that God would one day provide, his own son Jesus, who by his death would atone for the sins of God's people. God's people in Micah's day looked forward by faith to what God would do. We look back by faith at what God has done. And so all of our goodness, as blood-bought people of Christ, is a grateful response to the prior goodness of God. And if it's not that, right? If you're trying to do something else with your goodness, if you're trying to cut a bargain with God, it will fail, right? That has no currency with God. Goodness, biblical goodness, right? The goodness that the Spirit is building into you is a goodness that is responding to God's beautiful and generous and prior goodness to us, right? Okay? So what does that response look like? Well, that's the other three points, right? Second, goodness is, and this is all from verse 8, goodness is doing justice. Don't skip by the verb, right? Notice the emphasis on action here. You know, some aspects of our Christian DNA are more internal, right? You think about joy, think about peace. These are sorts of things that, you know, we have and possess and enjoy internally. But goodness, the goodness we have is reflected in action. It's what you do. And one of the things you do as a good person is justice. And in doing justice, you're imitating God, right? Psalm 103 6. God works vindication and justice for all who are oppressed. You know, there's nothing mysterious here. It's simple. I was trying to, you know, dig into the Hebrew, see if I could come up with any brilliant exegetical insights. I mean, doing justice is pretty simple. It's pretty straightforward. I mean, I think we get it, right? It means being honest. It means being fair with other people. It means treating other people with respect and integrity. It means giving to others what is due to them. It means, and this is important, it means struggling against injustice. And, you know, I'm concerned about Christians generally, but I'm particularly concerned about young Christians, because what I don't want to see happen is for young believers in Jesus to become cynical about the world. You know, as ambassadors of Jesus, you are called to do justice in this world and to fight injustice where you see it. And Christians have a long record of struggling against injustice. Injustice like slavery, racism, apartheid, sex trafficking. I mean, the list goes on. So goodness is doing justice. Third point, goodness is loving kindness, also in verse 8. The Hebrew word translated kindness there is one that is familiar to a lot of you at New Life. It's that wonderful Hebrew word chesed, which is notoriously difficult to translate into English. But think of it this way. If doing justice is about being fair to people, then loving kindness is about being unfair to people. And what I mean by that is unfair in the best sense of the word. If justice is about fairness, then chesed, kindness, is about mercy. Okay? And mercy is not about fairness. Mercy is mercy. Right? One commentator put it this way. Kindness gives where no giving is required. It acts when no action is deserved, and it penetrates both our attitudes and our activities, right? We're not only to love kindness, but we are to do it. You and I are called to look through, you know, to look at the world, to look at people through God's eyes. And as you see them through God's eyes, to give to them what Jesus would give them. Now, what does that look like? I mean, for you young people in school, it looks like not ganging up on the kid that everybody is teasing or bullying. You know, it's even if it means you're going to be teased, right? It looks like going over to that kid who's eating lunch alone during the lunch period and sitting with him and talking with him. You know, even if, again, you're going to be exposed to ridicule and teasing. For all of us, it certainly means thinking about how a post you're about to make on social media it is going to be felt by the people who will see it. Have you asked the question, is this kind? Am I reflecting the kindness of Jesus? It also means chesed. Kindness, keeping your commitments, right? Being faithful. For you married people, it means loving your spouse on those days when you don't like your spouse, right? hanging on, faithful to your commitments. Friends, you young people, look at the marriages around at New Life. Talk to people who've been married a long time. I mean, those marriages speak a lot of wisdom. And not only about being kind to one another and good to one another, but it also reflects how God loves us when you see a healthy marriage. The young people, look at the marriages here. They have something to teach you. So, right, we've learned that goodness is always responsive to God's goodness. It's doing justice, it's loving kindness, and finally, it's walking humbly with your God. Now, walking is the way the Hebrews talked about living. We would say, living by faith. They say walking by faith. So goodness is, living your life day to day and having that day to day living characterized by humility. You're humble before God, you're humble before other people. Now, why would that be good? Why would that be a part of goodness? Well, because you have no grounds, I have no grounds to be proud, right? I don't consistently get justice right. I don't do justice right all the time. And I don't consistently love kindness. And so if God's going to accept me, it's not on the basis of my perfect record of being, just and kind. It's going to depend on his mercy. And that makes us humble, or it should make us humble. Miroslav Volf is a Croatian Christian. He's a professor, theologian at Yale Divinity School, and written a lot about justice because he's seen injustice, in Croatia. And he really nails it in showing us how we get justice wrong when we try to do justice. He said it this way. He says, the principle cannot be denied. The fiercer the struggle against the injustice you suffer, the blinder you will be to the injustice you inflict. That's a very convicting sentence. We say it again. The fiercer the struggle against the injustice you suffer, the blinder you will be to the injustice you inflict. He goes on, we tend to translate the presumed wrongness of our enemies into an unfaltering conviction of our own rightness. In doing justice, in seeking to do justice, says Wolf, we pervert justice. Very easy to find myself in his principle there. And it's also true that why the godliest people I know are the humblest people I know. Because they're humble because they really know how much they don't measure up to the Lord that they love and the Lord that they serve, right? C.S. Lewis said it brilliantly in Mere Christianity. He said, when a man is getting better, he understands more and more clearly the evil that is still left in him. When a man is getting worse, he understands his own badness less and less. It's really true, right? Check out if it's true in your own experience, right? The godliest people you know are almost certainly the people who are the humblest and are most aware of how sinful they are. And we're looking at them going, really, you? But it's true. Well, let's put this all together. I in my reading, in preparation for this sermon, I came across a story that I think really nicely sort of fleshes each one of these elements out in a way that we can understand, in a way that we can imitate, I think. Corrie ten Boom, most of you are familiar with, would be familiar with Corrie ten Boom, the late Christian writer and speaker. She was a Holocaust survivor. She grew up in the Netherlands, in a Christian family. Her dad was a watchmaker and a Christian. They were the whole family was incarcerated in concentration camps because of their work in hiding Jews from the Nazis. Well, prior to that time, Corrie ten Boom was reflecting on a time when when her dad had the watch shop, well, you know, his watchmaker's shop, and the family was in just dire economic straits. There's real financial hardship. And one day, a wealthy customer enters the Ten Boom shop and buys the most expensive watch in the store, right? Like instantly, right? Financial problems solved. And as they were finalizing the sale, the customer happened to mention that the only reason he was buying a new watch was because a nearby young competitor, right, another watchmaker that was a competitor of Mr. Ten Boom, this young competitor couldn't fix his watch. And so Mr. Ten Boom asks to see the old watch, the one that was broken, and man had it. He handed it over to him, and after a few minutes of tinkering with it, Mr. Ten Boom hands it back. It's all fixed. And then the next thing Mr. Ten Boom handed him was all that money that he had just been given for the sale of that expensive watch that wealthy customer was now not going to buy, didn't need to buy it, right? And he said, your watch will be fine now, sir. And sir, I trust, this is Mr. Ten Boom speaking, I trust that young watchmaker. Someday he will be just as good as his father. And the customer walked out. And Corrie, young woman, was outraged what her dad did. Are you kidding? Let all that money walk out the door. What are you thinking, Dad, right? And think about what he did. In that simple but life-changing, I mean, really paradigm-busting, counter-cultural stuff going on there, right? He showed kindness to, he showed justice to the customer, right? He fixed his watch, and rather than selling him an expensive brand new one, even though he could have very easily done that, he showed him justice. He showed the young competitor kindness, unbelievable kindness, right? He built him up rather than tear him down. And Mr. Ten Boom showed humility before God and his neighbors, didn't he, in that one little transaction? He didn't make it about himself. He didn't make it about his big sale. He didn't make it about his reputation. It was all about doing what would please God and trusting God with the results. Friends, there, right there, in a five-minute transaction, right, that's where Christianity, you know, the rubber of Christianity hits the road. And you know, one simple commercial transaction, and it's life-changing. That's the goodness to which God is calling you and me, and to which we can all do. And if you multiply that kind of goodness, right, by all of you, think about how we could impact our community. So finally, where do we find the power to be that way, to be that good? Well, we find it, not surprisingly, right, where the justice of God and the kindness of God, right, And remember what goodness is. It's doing justice and loving kindness. We find the power to be good where the justice of God and the kindness of God intersect. And they intersect, of course, right at the cross of Jesus. At the cross, we see the justice of God, right? That's what is killing Jesus. God has made him the sin offering for the sins of his people. And God's justice is coming down on Jesus. The cross is a terrifying picture of divine judgment. But it's also a knee-weakening picture of kindness, because God meted that justice out on his Son and not on you and me. It's unbelievable kindness. God forbids us, right? Here in Micah, he outright rejects the horrible notion that we should get right with him by sacrificing our firstborn child. And yet God himself gave up his one and only Son to atone for your sin and your shame. And if you let that marinate in your mind and in your heart, it's going to warm your heart. And it will propel you to be a good person, to be fair, to be just, to be kind and merciful and humble. I mean, what a magnetic kind of combination, right? Just a quick closing word. We saw last week an appalling absence of goodness in our country, particularly in Minneapolis, right? The police who choked George Floyd to death, the protesters whose reaction to the evil became evil itself as some of them burned and looted the city. Millions more are righteously outraged and sad, but mostly silent because they don't know what to do. Christians, we know. Law, passing laws, does not generate goodness. Education doesn't generate goodness. Public spending doesn't produce goodness. Government doesn't produce goodness. What produces goodness at an organic heart level, right, is the gospel of Jesus Christ. People need to be spiritually rebirthed one person at a time. You want to change our country, our cities for the better? You want to change our world for the better? Then dedicate yourself to proclaiming and living out the gospel of Jesus Christ. You can change your community. You can change the world one person at a time as we go out agents of Jesus Christ, bearers of the good news that has the power to make us new and good people. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for your Holy Spirit and presence with us. And I pray, Lord, that you would help me and all of my brothers and sisters in New Life to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. And as we gaze at him and pray and consider all that he is and all that he's done, Holy Spirit, transform us into the same image, that we might be people who bear the same sort of spiritual DNA as Jesus. We pray that we would be good people. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And now we come to what is in our services, the time where we respond to the goodness, the prior goodness of God with our gifts and our offerings. I want to thank all of you who have been faithful in giving your gifts and offerings to the church and allowing us to do the work here during the COVID shutdown. And I know that's a sacrifice because this one of the great impacts of this coronavirus has been the hit on the economy, and yet you still have been generous, and we're very, very thankful. But I'm also mindful that there are some who may not be able to give at all because of job losses and unpaid bills and everything else. We're here to help. You know, our deacons stand ready. We have the resources. We have the manpower. Please don't be embarrassed or ashamed to give our office a call, and we'd love to help you out. That's why we are here. It's one of the reasons why we are here. Okay, and now let's close out our worship.
The power, of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole world with holy thunder and leads us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is a failing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life, that I would be set free. To sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules a nation with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of his brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is a failing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. And this is amazing grace. This is a failing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Pastor Ted referenced what took place a couple weeks ago with George Floyd, and by now all of us have seen that clip. Tremendous injustice, and what immediately filled my heart was rage, and it was maddening. I literally wanted to, you know, pick up a laptop and throw it across the room. It's been a long time where something on a video got me that upset. And yet the reality is that's the world that we live in, a world of tremendous injustice, in some places just a complete lack of goodness. But of course, what took place in Minneapolis isn't what happens everywhere all the time. There are lesser, smaller degrees of injustice taking place all over. And yet it's into this world and into that context that our God has come and he has entered into this world and come, and he has given up everything to redeem us and set us apart, and he calls us into those places to be his salt and light, to be his ambassadors that would demonstrate kingdom goodness. And so as God sends you out this week into your neighborhoods and into your schools and into your workplaces, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.